is related with addressing modes. So with respect to IO management, there are two different addressing modes are available. First one is the memory mapped IO and second one is the IO mapped IO. So in case of memory mapped IO, so this is the figure in which CPU, memory, different IO devices are directly communicated with the help of different buses. So with memory mapped IO input output device, there is a single address space for memory locations and input output devices. So processor treats status and data registers as a separate memory locations. So status and data registers are part of input and output devices. So processor uses the same memory instructions to access both memory and input output devices. So with memory mapped IO, a single read line and a single write line are needed on the bus. So only single read and write line are needed. Next one is the IO mapped IO. So in case of IO mapped IO, there are separate control lines for memory and output devices. A memory reference instructions does not affect an input and output device. So there are separate address spaces for memory and output devices. And input and output devices and a memory locations can have the same address. So there are separate instructions for input and output read and input and output write. So in case of both memory mapped and IO mapped IO, there are different separate address lines are available for communication purpose. So in case of memory mapped, only single line is available for communication purpose. So with and both addressing modes are available inside the programmed IO. So next point is related with IO buffering. So in case of IO buffering, why IO buffering is required? Suppose whatever be the module which you have been considered for data transfer, its data transfer rate is high as compared to CPU. So in that case, your IO device has to wait for some time. And in another case, if you are using high configuration CPU and normal IO devices, in that case your CPU want to wait for data transfer. So in that case, IO buffering is most important to increase the efficiency of the operating system and performance of the individual process. So buffering is done in the for the following for the different reasons. So first one is the speed mismatch between the CPU and IO devices. Next one is the devices have different data transfer size. Another one is the overlapping of input and output processing. Next one is it increases the efficiency of the operating system. So with respect to IO buffering, data is transferred with the help of two different orientation. First one is the block orientation and second one is the stream orientation. So in case of block orientation, information is stored in the fixed blocks and transfer are made with respect to these blocks. And in case of stream oriented, transfer information are of stream bytes. For example, the terminals, printers, communication ports. So these are the different buffering mechanisms, and these are the different characteristics which we already discussed. So first type under the buffering is the single buffer. So in case of operating system, assigns a buffer in main memory for an IO device. So block oriented, input transfers are made to buffer, blocks moved to user space when they are needed. Another one is the input transfer are made to the system buffer. In this case approach, when the user process is processing one block of data, the next blocks can be read into the system buffer. So similarly, in the case of output buffer, the data to be sent to the output device are copied into the system buffer, from which the data will be picked by your IO device. So in case of single buffer, they are using block oriented concept. So he is going to pick all these processes block by block for swap in purpose or as well as swap out purpose. So this is the figure with respect to single buffer. First one is related with no buffer. Buffer is not available in that case. So directly data is transmitted in as well as with respect to user processes. But in case of a single buffer, buffer is available and only that buffer is going to accept the data and move inside the user process. Next one is the double buffer. Two different buffers are available inside the two buffer or two buffer system instead of single one. So one buffer is busy with user process at that time, the another buffer is going to receive some data from the user as well as from the IO device. So that's why double buffer is used to increase the efficiency. Next one is the circular buffer. So in case of circular buffer, more than two buffers are used. So it generates or it designs the cycle for all these buffers. So each individual buffer is one unit in a circular buffer used when IO operations must keep up with the processes. So in this case, this collection of buffers can be treated as a circular buffer to allow first in first out operations. So next one we will discuss is the magnetic disk. So magnetic disk or physical disk organization with respect to data storage. So in that case, a magnetic disk is a circular platter of the plastic that is coated with the magnetization material. The disks are mounted on a rotating drive so that magnetized surface move in close proximity to read and write the head. So these disks rotate at a uniform speed. Each head consists of a magnetic point or magnetic coil. So there are the different characteristics with respect to this physical disk. First one is related with fixed head or movable head. Next one is different slides are available. Next, different platters are available. Then the mechanism of that particular head. So with respect to this physical disk is divided into multiple sectors, or to read the data from that physical disk, read write head is required. And to identify the position of that read write head, we are using different tracks. So these are the different components where we are using this particular read write head. So all these different platters are mounted on a single spindle motor. So to read or to write operation with respect to platter, two different read write heads are required on both sides, or arm actuator is required to assemble all these read write heads. And all these platters are divided into multiple sectors. So all these platters are spinning in 90 RPMs. The arm assemble is moved in or out to position a head on a desired track. So tracks under the heads make a cylinder. So only one head reads and write at a time. So if suppose multiple read write heads are there, but only one read write head is active at one time. So disk drive technology. So several platters are available. They are combined with the help of spindle motor. So to read both the surfaces, we require two different read write heads. So all these platters are divided into multiple tracks. So middle one are called as inner tracks, and outer are called as outer tracks. Those are represented in the green color. So middle one are the sectors. So actuator arm head over the track or select surface wait over the sector rotator under the read write head. Cylinder means all tracks under one's read write head. So one actuator arm is required to mount all these read write heads. So this is the figure with respect to this physical disk. So this is called as actuator arm. Actuator, this is the arm, this is the head, this is the spindle motor. These are the different platters. I think in this particular figure they have mentioned 12 different platters. So to read 12 platters require 24 read write heads on both the side, and depend upon that we are calculate the disk performance of this particular physical disk. So we are calculate the seek time, or to measure the speed. So these are the different factors or parameters which we are going to consider to read or write data. So to read or write data, the disk head must be positioned on the desired track and at the beginning of the desired sector. So seek time is the time takes by your read write head on the desired track. So movement of your track from one track to another track is nothing but seek time. So rotational delay or rotational latency is the additional time it takes for the beginning of the sector to reach the particular location. It's called as rotational delay. Next one is the transfer time. So transfer time means transfer time is the time for the sector to pass under the head. So once data is available for particular sector, so from that sector the time required under to read write head. So access time is calculated with the help of formula seek time plus rotational time plus transfer time. Efficiency is calculated with the help of formula efficiency of a sequence of disk. Access strongly depends on the order of the request. Adjust request on the same track, avoid additional seeks and rotational latency. Or loading a files as a unit is efficient when the files have or has stored on consecutive sectors on the same cylinder of the disk. So this is the example they have given to calculate the rotational adjacent sectors time which is required to calculate the read write head. So disk performance is majorly read with the help of two different parameters which we already discussed. First one is the seek time, time required to or time takes to move your read write head from one location to another location, and rotational delay or latency means the time takes from beginning to the to reach to particular head. So this is the timing diagram with respect to disk IO transfer. So seek time, rotational time and data transfer time. So access time is nothing but the time required from seek and rotational delay. So data transfer occurs the sector moves under the read write head. So there are different disk scheduling policies they have mentioned that. So we will discuss all these disk scheduling policies in the next PPT. Thank you.